Open your Bibles. Come on, let's get to it. The clock says time for a Bible study. Let's have one, huh? Title of the message this morning, Fiery Trials. Ugh. All the air gets sucked out of the room. Fiery Trials, Daniel chapter 3. We're only going to do the first 30 verses in Daniel chapter 3. Hold on, listen to me close. I'm going to tell you what the message is about. God uses the fire of our trials for our good. God uses the fire of our trials for our good. Sometimes when the fire of our trials is so hot, we think for sure we're going to be destroyed, but instead, the Lord wants to meet us right in the midst of that fiery trial. And He has a purpose and He has a plan, and it's for our good and it's for His glory. God uses the fire of our trials. And He uses them for our good. He'll use them for our good and for His glory if, that's a conditional word, if we'll join Him in what He's doing instead of fight Him, if we'll trust Him instead of question Him, if we will have the unbending faith to meet Him in the midst of the fiery trial, if we'll do that, God will meet us there and He will do something great in the midst of our fiery trials. Listen, we have a part. We have a part. God does the work, but we have a part. Here's our part. Here's our role. We must never bow. In the midst of the fire, we must never bow. We must take our stand to trust God completely, no matter what. No matter what the circumstances are, no matter how hot the fire feels, we must never bow. We must never bow to the gods of self or the gods of this world. We must never bend the knee, but stand firm in our faith, in our trust, in our confidence in God, waiting to see how He's going to bring us through. God uses the fire of our trials in our lives for our good and for His glory. That's the whole message. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, please bring it to life, Lord. As Your word, Lord, is living and powerful, it transforms our hearts. It focuses our mind. It gives us new perspective, Lord. And we need it, Lord. We need it so bad, Lord. Do it today, supernaturally, miraculously, and to transform us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So some years ago, an archaeologist found what is now called the Mounds of Dura. It's a brick structure that goes 45 feet in length and stands 20 feet high. And apparently, it was used as a pedestal for something very, very huge. It was found just outside where the ancient city of Babylon was. So in Daniel chapter 2, King Nebuchadnezzar had a dream. And there was a huge statue with a head of gold, and Daniel told him that he represented, his kingdom represented, or the head of gold represented him and his kingdom, the Babylonian Empire. Now, as we go into chapter 3, it is possibly 15 to 20 years later. It takes us a millisecond to move from chapter 2 to chapter 3, but historically time has passed at least 15 years, and I think that dream has been gnawing at Nebuchadnezzar. You know how that is. Stuff that you've experienced many, many years ago still gnawing at you. Most of that you need to release to God and experience a healing and let go of it, but that's not what Nebi did. Instead, King Nebi said, why am I just the head? What's up with that? Why can't I be the whole statue? And then he thought to himself, wait a minute. I can be the whole statue. I can be the whole statue of gold because I can build it. Probably the scholars estimate, hypothesize maybe, theorize, I guess is the right word, might be the gold from Jerusalem that Nebuchadnezzar took when he took Jerusalem. In any case, we read in Daniel 3, verse 1, King Nebuchadnezzar made a gold statue. How high? 90 feet tall. 90 feet tall. That's in essence 9 stories and 9 feet wide. I think he had a weight complex because that's a real skinny statue, right? Only 9 feet wide, but 90 feet tall. I mean, that's a tall, skinny statue. 90 feet tall and 9 feet wide, and he set it up on the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon, where, listen carefully to how I word this, please, the Bible confirms archaeology. Let me just say that again. The Bible confirms that archaeology is true. All right, you remember to word it that way the next time you tell somebody. There's a massive gold statue, 90 feet tall, 9 feet wide, placed on a 20-foot high pedestal just outside of Babylon on the plain of Dura. And it seems like Nebuchadnezzar was doing what so many world rulers have done since him, since he was the first. It seems like he wanted to unite his kingdom religiously. He wanted to unite his kingdom religiously. All world rulers and all rulers of large kingdoms understand the power of doing this. He was trying to unify his kingdom religiously. And since he needed a deity to unify the kingdom in worshiping, what better deity than himself? How could there be a better deity for a world ruler like Nebuchadnezzar? He wasn't the last one. All the world rulers have had God complexes, and you might say, oh, that's the problem. no, I got to stop that. I got to stop that thought. All right, Hitler was on his way to doing this. You know, there was a plan to deify Hitler. He was in the process of that and uniting Hitler Germany, his Germany, around the worship of him as a deity. We know that the Antichrist will do the exact same thing, and from a place, if not the actual place, that Nebuchadnezzar is doing it. So Nebi builds a 90-foot gold statue of himself. We pick up in verse 2 of Daniel 3. Daniel 3, 2, then he sent messengers to the high officers, officials, governors, advisors, treasurers, and judges, magistrates, and all the provincial officials to come to the dedication of the statue that he had set up. This is everybody. These are all the high-ranking people, all the officials, all the important people, all the VIPs, of which Daniel had made Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego at the end of chapter 2 as a result of the whole dream deal with Nebuchadnezzar. So the Hebrews, we always call them Hebrew boys because we make that jump from chapter 2 to chapter 3 so quickly, but at the very least, they're men, young men now. Daniel 3, verse 3. So all these officials came and stood before the statue King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Then a herald shouted out, "People of all races and nations and languages, listen to the king's command. When you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, the zither, the lyre, the harp, the pipes, and other musical instruments, bow. Bow to the ground to worship King Nebuchadnezzar's gold statue." Again, the first ruler of the world wanted to be worshiped, and not much has changed since 600 BC. It kind of goes with the position. So Nebuchadnezzar attached his signature motivation. This is how not to motivate people. Daniel 3, verse 6. "Anyone who refuses to obey will immediately be thrown into a blazing furnace." So, rulers have followed in his footsteps motivation-wise too. Also a poor choice. Verse 7, "So at the sound of the musical instruments, all the people, whatever their race or nation or language, bowed to the ground and worshiped the gold statue that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up." There was just one little problem. Some of those bowing were bowing with one eye open. Have you ever been praying around the table with the little ones? We do this with our grandkids. It's really fun. And they'll start praying like this, and then they'll like open an eye. And they'll be looking around like, what's going on? What are we really doing? Our little Willa does that all the time. All right, so some of the wise men, the Babylonian wise men, the king's wise men, were bowing with one eye open because the king's wise men were keeping an eye on who? On the Hebrew wise men. Why? Because 15 years of bitterness and jealousy and resentment and animosity had been growing between the king's wise men who got dissed bad in chapter 2 and the Hebrew wise men we know as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Those three Hebrew servants of the Most High God would not bow. They would not bow to the king's statue. We read in verse 8 of Daniel 3, but some of the astrologers went to the king, and I like the way the NLT phrases this, informed on the Jews. Some of the king's astrologers, some of the astrologers went to the king and informed on the Jews. These, again, are the guys that were one-upped, if you would, in chapter 2 when they couldn't interpret the dream and God revealed the dream to Daniel and Daniel interpreted the dream and then he brought his prayer team. If you remember in chapter 2, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were Daniel's prayer team, and so he brought them in at the end of the chapter and put them in these official positions. Well, there was some hurt egos over that. There was some bitterness growing over that. There was about 15 years of animosity growing over that. And I just wanted to focus on this a little bit. So if this is you, grab a hold of this for me. I have actually been put into some pretty fiery trials by people with the same motives as these pinhead astrologers of the king. Maybe some of you have been put into fiery trials by people like this as well. It happens not only in the world's workplace, maybe it's happened to you in the workplace. I want you to know, in all honesty, it happens way too much in the church. Here's what I found after, I guess, 30 years almost in church leadership in one way or another. Churches are full of sinners. I mean, wall to wall, floor to ceiling, 100%, they get packed with sinners. So I hope that didn't shock you. But there's something that used to make me sick, because it impacted me so heavily in my early days of ministry when I was naive and thought that God wasn't using sinners. He only used, people had gotten over that. Well, he doesn't, because he'd have no one to use. And so I've been put in fiery trials like this, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are about to be put into. And it used to really, really just destroy me in so many ways. Now it just makes me cynical, and so I turn the evil. I'm doing my best. I'm doing my best to crucify the cynicism too. But I just want you to know that you need to understand, and we need to understand, that this type of stuff doesn't just happen in the workplace. It happens in the church, because the church is full of us, a bunch of sinners. Verse 9 of Daniel 3, here's what I'm talking about. The astrologers go to the king and they've got a special approach. Daniel 3, verse 9, they, the astrologers, said to King Nebuchadnezzar, long live the king. Oh, shut up. I already don't like these people. Verse 10, they say, king, you issued a decree requiring all the people to bow down and worship the gold statue when they hear the sound of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harp, pipes, and other musical instruments, right? Yes, I did. Verse 11, that decree also states that those who refuse to obey must, right, King? Must be thrown into a blazing furnace, remember? In our world today, it's like, you know what the Bible says, right? Right? You know what the Bible says as they're pulling their sword out to run somebody through. You know, you remember that decree, right? That they have to be thrown into the blazing furnace? Verse 12. But King, there are some Jews. Roots of anti-Semitism there. There are some Jews, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, whom you have put in charge of the province of Babylon. A little animosity there. King, they pay no attention to you, your majesty. They refuse to serve your gods and do not worship the gold statue you've set up. I just thought I'd share it with you because I'm, you know, concerned for you and your kingdom. Ah, man, go put your head in the sand somewhere. Don't ever do that to me, please. Like, come into me and tell me how bad somebody else is, because the whole time I'm feeling like, you know, I'm feeling about these guys. Like, really? What are you doing this for? What's your real motivation? Why would you seek me out to tell me something's wrong with somebody else? Is there a chance there's an ulterior motive? Probably only 100%. Maybe only 99%. I know some of you are like, oh man, I've done that. He hates me. No, I don't hate you. I love you. And when you leave, I go, yep, Lord, another sinner. All of us, right? I mean, I just move over on that side of the table with you. We're all sinners. We do this, man. Be afraid. Be afraid of your flesh. Be afraid of your sin nature, man. It's awful. So, happens all the time in worldly politics. That's why it should never happen in the church, but it's also why it happens in the church. I could go off on a little bit of a tangent there, but I won't. So, these guys are one up. They see an opportunity to, as St. Paul says, St. Paul McCartney, get back to where you once belong, okay? All right, that's not my own joke. They see a way to get their position back. They see a way to improve their standing with the king. And again, if you've had this happen to you like I have in the workplace or in church politics, someone that read the wrong book that said the best way to climb the ladder is to build up dead bodies to climb on. And so they just take people out to climb up the ladder on them. Wow. So really, I think every church leader I know has at one time been attacked and maligned and slandered by somebody with an ulterior motive. Can I get off that? Can you tell it's a personal thing? It's a personal thing. I'll get off it now. Except, can I just say this? If you find yourself in a trial by people doing what these wise men did to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, this message is for you. It applies to you. So quit getting so like, your feelings hurt, all right? I know, I've been there. I spent decades just agonizing over this stuff. Listen, you're a sinner, they're a sinner, we're all sinners, and get over it. Forgive and go on serving the Lord. Do not bow to this kind of stuff. Don't bow to it. Don't let the enemy use it to take you out. You have got to stand firm in Christ. And if you will, if you'll just stand in Him and in His trust and trusting Him and in confidence in Him, He'll get you through the fire. He'll get you through. You don't have to worry about other people who try to make themselves look bad by making you hold it. I wish. Hey, that would be a good idea. I should write a book. How to make yourself look bad by making others look good. That's how it should be. That would be very Christian. But instead, what it is they make you look bad so they will look good. Let it go. Let it go. Don't bow to it. Don't get taken out by it. Don't be affected by it. It's like, yeah, okay. All right, I think we've all agreed here. We're a bunch of sinners saved by grace, and sometimes sinners act like sinners. Let's move on. If you're in a fiery trial, that one or any other, if you're in a fiery trial, hear me when I say you have got to keep your eyes firmly fixed on the Lord Jesus Christ. You have got to keep your eyes firmly fixed on Him. You've got to be consumed with Him. You cannot let your mind wander. You have got to set your mind on the things of eternity. You have got to be looking over the horizon. You've got to understand there's an eternal plan and an eternal purpose. And let me tell you something about God's eternal plans and eternal purposes. Normally, you don't know what they are. You're clueless. I'm clueless. We're clueless. God, I have no idea why you allowed me into this fiery trial. I don't know. And he's like, duh. I don't need a fourth in the Trinity. Of course you don't know. Get it? All right? When people say, well, I just want to understand God. You know, I don't say this stuff. I'm so much nicer on the outside than I am on the inside. But I think, yeah, of course you don't know. There's not a fourth seat for the Trinity. Of course you don't know what God's doing. That's the whole deal. So you have to trust that God's doing something. And just say, Lord, I trust you. I trust you. I trust you. I trust you in this. Stand firm and do not bow. Do not bow in any way in the fiery trials that you're on the edge of or that you're in that confront you. Let's look at the revenge plan. It almost works. Sometimes you think, Lord, I'm actually going through this. I mean, this is actually happening. Verse 13 of Daniel 3. Then Nebuchadnezzar flew into a rage, just as planned, and ordered that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego be brought before him. When they were brought in, Nebuchadnezzar said to them, is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you refuse to serve my gods or to worship the gold statue I have set up? Verse 15, I will give you one more chance to bow down and worship the statue I have made when you hear the sound of the musical instruments. But if you refuse, you will be thrown immediately into the blazing furnace. Now here's Nebi's mistake, the last sentence. And then what God will be able to rescue you from my power? Ha! What God? Oh, that was a mistake. That's what you call a line in the sand. All right, the battle line is drawn now. Nebuchadnezzar says, what God will be able to save you from my power? This becomes a showdown. The battle lines are drawn, and this is where you're at when you're in a fiery trial. The battle lines are drawn. This is these boys' moment. This is their chance. This is their opportunity to truly glorify God. Can I tell you, please, that your purpose for your place, for your movement through a fiery trial is to glorify God. It's to glorify God. That's what you've been made to do. That's what God's given you an opportunity to do. That's what you have the choice to do. This is your moment. This is your moment. And when you see yourself going into a trial like that, you need to say, Lord, this is my moment. The battle line has been drawn, Lord. This is a war. And I have to decide how I'm going to handle this trial. And am I going to bring you glory? Not promote myself, not lift myself up, not just get out of the trial, but am I going to truly demonstrate a genuine faith in you that will bring you glory? Can I say it again? In this fiery trial, Lord, am I truly going to demonstrate a genuine faith that will bring you glory? Or am I going to fold? Am I going to bow to my own selfish needs? Am I going to bow to the things, the little g gods of this world? Am I going to bow to this trial, or am I going to stand firm, trusting that you're going to do something great in me and through me? Do you see the battle line? Do you understand where the battle line's at? Have you been taken out? I know you have. If you've been a Christian any time, you're thinking, I just like click, click, click through them. Like, yeah, I failed that one. Oh, yeah, I really failed that one. Oh. And then I say, what how am I doing now? When, Lord? When am I going to take a stand for you? When am I going to trust you implicitly? When am I going to trust you no matter what the circumstances are? When am I going to truly begin to bring you glory through my unwavering faith? Here's the question, how? Say how.
How?
How do we do it? How do these boys do it? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Do they rise up and give a response as fiery as the furnace they're about to get thrown into? Ah, what shall you, king? Do they call in their accusers and dismantle them word by word? Some of you are verbal dismantlers. And you just bring someone in and just systematically take them down. I know you. Because in my sinful self, I am you. And I'm scared to death of that sin nature. Is that the way you do it? Is that the way you bring God glory? If you're new to this, let me just tell you, not at all. Opposite. Contrary. You take it into your hands. You gain control. You start defending yourself and taking your enemies down. God's like, well, I'm just going to be over here. You just give me a holler when you want to do something my way. Here's the way. Here's the way Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego do it, all right? And here's the way you and I can do it. We can demonstrate miraculous, supernatural trust in the God who loves us and in His sovereignty. We can demonstrate supernatural, miraculous faith in the midst of a fiery trial. We can respond the same way that these three Hebrew saints, these heroes of the faith, responded. Here's our example to follow. It's in Daniel 3, verse 16. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied, gently, I'm sure, O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you. Bam! When was the last time you said that in the midst of a major conflict, of a fiery trial? Oh, Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you. Have you done that in perfect peace? Say, I don't need to defend myself in this place. Or how often maybe have your actions been totally defined by your attempts to defend yourself? How often in these situations are our actions defined by our ability, our refined, sharpened ability to defend ourselves? Guys, so many of us have become so good at defending ourselves, we wouldn't even allow God to defend us because we know we can do a much better job than Him. God, I got this, all right? I got this. I don't need none of your, like, you know, peace and comfort and, you know, I'm taking care of this business right here. Yeah, yeah. And the enemy's going, see? To God. See, I got him. Didn't even have to work, man. Watch how I'll use him to destroy a bunch of other Christians. This is going to be fun. And God's just like, so glad my sovereign plan's going to work out in the end. You know, as he watches us just mess this stuff up. That's not the way God's glorified. Can I just tell you that? When you take a defensive position, I have to be careful with my vocabulary. When you take a defensive position and start demanding and defending and challenging God, God's not glorified by that. He's not glorified by it. Look again how these three did it. Watch closely. Daniel 3, 16 again with 17. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied, O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God whom we serve is able to save us. He will rescue us from your power, your majesty. Look carefully again. Our God, the God whom we serve, is able, more than able, to save us. And then they say, He will. He is able, and He will rescue us from your hand, some of the literal versions say, from your hand or your power. Hear it again. It's a key of the message. He is able to save us and he will rescue us. God is able to save you and he will rescue you. He is able to save you and he will rescue you. If, please hear me when I say this, if you belong to God today through faith in Jesus Christ, if you've been adopted into his family, God will rescue you. Ultimately, he will completely 100% rescue you. Why? Because that work of your ultimate rescue is finished. It is finished. When Jesus cried out on the cross, it is finished. The work of your ultimate rescue was finished. The rescue is complete because the rescue was finished on the cross. He will rescue you from your trials. He will rescue you from the hand of this world, from the power of this world. He will rescue you from what you're going through because that complete rescue is a finished work in Jesus Christ on your behalf, and you receive the finished work through faith in him. Say amen. Amen. So your victory is complete. It's assured. Nothing can ever separate you from it. And there's nothing in this life, neither life nor death, that can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Your ultimate rescue is assured. In addition, did you hear me say that? In addition, God is able to save you from the fiery trial that you're in or that you're on the precipice of. He's able to save you from your current trials as well. Here's the problem. Sometimes we have a hard time accepting the difference between the two. Sometimes we have a hard time accepting the difference that God has ultimately guaranteed your complete and eternal rescue from all of the effects of sin in this world. It is guaranteed, and he is able to save you from your current fiery trial. What that means is that he may or may not bring you through your trial the way you would prefer. He may or may not bring you through your trial in the way you would if you were God. But your ultimate rescue is guaranteed. And he is able to bring you through the trial that you're in. This is exactly what these three saints are saying to this king. This is the pinnacle of us glorifying God in our lives. Can I tell you, please hear me. This is the pinnacle of us glorifying God in our lives. When we say in the midst of the fiery trial, my God has guaranteed my ultimate rescue and he is more than able to save me from this trial. I know my ultimate rescue is sure. Again, let's read verse 17 of Daniel 3. Along with verse 18, again, the boys say, if we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God whom we serve is able to save us, period. He will rescue us from your power, your majesty. And look at verse 18. But even if he doesn't, meaning even if he doesn't save us from this current fiery trial, even if he doesn't, we want to make it clear to you, your majesty, that we will never serve your gods or worship the gold statue you have set up. We will never bow, no matter what. Because we are in Christ. We are assured of our victory. It is complete and finished. And we will stand in this fiery trial no matter what. We will not bow to the gods of self. We will not bow to the gods of this world. We will not bow. We'll stand on the rock of Jesus Christ. We'll hold on to our salvation. We'll stay focused on Christ. And he will walk us through one way or the other. Say amen for me. Come on. That means you agree. God is able to save you, and he will rescue you. That's the ultimate position of bringing glory to God. And if he doesn't deliver you from this current fiery trial, you make one thing clear in your mind. You will never bow. You will never bend a knee to your self-centered desires. You will never bend a knee to the gods of this world. You will never question God, but you will stand firm in your faith no matter what, because you know His ultimate rescue is guaranteed. He's able to save you. He's guaranteed a rescue. There's only one thing that's not going to happen. I know I'm repeating myself. It hasn't set in that much yet. Listen. The one thing you cannot do is you cannot bow. You cannot break your stand in ultimate faith that God is going to see you through the trial you're in. We'll never bow to self or to the world. We'll stand steadfast and immovable in the midst of our fiery trial because we know that God is able to save us and that He will rescue us. I know I repeated it. Now, this is a problem. If you say this to a God complex king who has the key to the furnace, Daniel 3 verse 19, as we move on quickly, Nebuchadnezzar was so furious with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego that his face became distorted. I don't know what my face looks like. I don't know what that means. Like the Hulk, his face became distorted with rage. All right, that can't be good. He commanded that the furnace be heated 7 times hotter than usual. Then he ordered some of the strongest men of his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and throw them into the blazing furnace. So they tied them up and threw them into the furnace, fully dressed in their pants, turbans, robes, and other garments. And because the king, in his anger, had demanded such a hot fire in the furnace, the flames killed the soldiers as they threw these 3 men in. This is intense, all right? This is a very intense scene. Can I just tell you something? I spent some time in Fontana, all right? Lived there for a while, and a nice enough place to live, a little windy, but that's where the Kaiser plant was, and I know one thing about a smelting furnace. Do you know something about a smelting furnace? It's where they melt steel into molten steel, right? All right, a smelting furnace is a closed furnace, but it has a door and what's called a loading platform. And the loading platform is the most dangerous place in the refinery because when the smelting door is opened, there is such a vacuum as the heat of that fire sucks fresh oxygen into it that if anybody's standing on the loading platform when the smelting door is open, the fire just sucks them right in. That's physics, okay? That's the real deal. That's what happened to these guys. Okay, that's a hot fire. Verse 16 of Daniel 3. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, securely tied, fell into that type of fire, the roaring flames. Guys, sometimes it looks like God is not going to save you from your current fiery trial. Sometimes it starts to look pretty hopeless. Like when you're flying through the air into a white hot furnace and the guys that just threw you got vaporized by the heat. That's about the time you start thinking, this doesn't look so good. Okay? This could be a real problem for me. And sometimes something happens that's even more shocking than the trial. Sometimes something happens that you never expected to happen. Sometimes if you'll face that fiery trial with the faith that we see in these three here, if you'll go in knowing that either God's going to deliver you from this trial or He's going to rescue you ultimately, sometimes what happens when you hit the bottom of the trial, you will find out that Jesus Christ is there waiting for you. Come on. Listen. You're going in and you're thinking it's hopeless. And then you like wake up and you go, Lord, you're here? I didn't think you'd be here. He's saying, why? Why did you think I would not be here? Didn't I tell you there was nothing that could separate you from me? Didn't I tell you when you walk through the fire, you'll not be burned? Why would you not expect to meet me here? Sometimes the biggest shock about our fiery trial is if we'll go in with the faith and open our eyes, we will meet Jesus Christ in the middle of that fire like we could meet Him no other way. every person I know that's truly met Jesus Christ in the midst of what looks like a hopeless, fiery trial, they have met him in a way that no other situation could produce. Sometimes when you hit the bottom, you find out that the Lord wanted to have a fireside chat with you. That the Lord Jesus wanted to meet you in the fire. And that he let you come in so that he could meet you there. And so that you could know him there like you can know him no other way. Amen. What we want is to not even feel a spark from that fire. Oh, Lord, I think a spark got on me. What Jesus wants is to meet us in the middle of the fire. What we want is comfort and ease in this life. What Jesus Christ wants is to prepare us for eternity. Lord, this is difficult, Lord. This life is what it's all about. No, it's not. Eternity is what it's all about. This is, you know, in football, they call it Hell Week, you know. It just prepares you for the season. This prepares us for eternity. We think it's the big game. Jesus is like, are you kidding me? You're in week one of boot camp. What we want is for Jesus to make this life easier and better. What Jesus wants is to use us for his glory. Let me say it again. What we want is for Jesus to make this life easier and better. What Jesus wants is to use us for his glory. Sometimes his eternal good is meeting us in the midst of the fire. Sometimes his eternal good is meeting us in the midst of the fire. That was his plan for these boys in verse 24 of Daniel 3. Wow, I got behind somehow. Verse 24, Daniel 3. But suddenly, you know, the watch only does good if you actually watch it. But suddenly, Nebuchadnezzar jumped up in amazement and exclaimed to his advisors, didn't we tie up three men and throw them into the furnace? Yes, your majesty, we certainly did. They reply. Verse 25, look, Nebuchadnezzar shouted, I see four men unbound, walking around in the fire unharmed, and the fourth looks like a god. All right, this is it right here. Now, some of your translations have taken a literary license and said son of God and even capitalized the son. Can I just share with you, this is an Aramaic idiom. What it means is it's a common phrase that the Chaldeans use to describe someone who came from deity. And so the most literal translation of that is like a son of the gods, like one who comes from deity. Here's why some of the translations take the license to make it a capital S, because most scholars agree easily that this is a pre-incarnate manifestation of Jesus Christ, formerly called a Christophany. You can say it. It's kind of fun. Christophany. Oh, yeah, it's a Christophany. What? Is that what we're having for lunch? No. It's a pre-incarnate manifestation of Jesus Christ. This is the Lord. We believe this is the Lord. Nebuchadnezzar even calls him an angel later because he doesn't have that framework to say son of God. This is the Lord Jesus, the fourth man in the fire. He's deity, and he's come to have a fireside chat with you. And the whole time you were thinking that he had forgotten you. The whole time you were thinking, where's the Lord? Why has he left me here as you're falling into the flames? Why has he left me? And then you wake up and you go, oh, silly me. You wanted to meet me here. You wanted to walk with me through this. It's suddenly, there's something more valuable than avoiding the trial. What's more valuable eternally is meeting Christ in the midst of the trial. He wants to meet you there. He wants you to know him there like you can no other way. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and you, if you belong to the Lord, they were in a no-lose situation. How? How could they be? Because they're either going to be walking around in the fire with Jesus, or they're going to be walking around in heaven with Jesus. All right? I mean, that's what we call by winning. Thank you very much. I should not have used that example. Okay. That is a win-win situation. It's a win-win situation. You walk with Jesus through the trial, or you walk with him in person in heaven in glory. Listen, if you're in Christ, your win is guaranteed. Maybe through this trial, but guaranteed for sure for eternity. Jesus wants to meet you in the midst, or he wants to bring you to his presence for eternity. It's a win-win. In John chapter 6, Jesus sent, he made, Mark 6 says, he made his disciples get in the boat and go into the storm. Why? So that they could meet him in the midst of the storm. Maybe God has sent you into a trial so that he can meet you in that trial. Amen, man. For his purpose, for his glory. If that's true for you, please hear me when I say God has promised without fail. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. And there is nothing that can separate you from his love in Christ. Your love and care and victory is guaranteed in Christ. It's a finished work. You can rest in it. So if he allows you into the fire of tribulation, know that he's promised to be there with you, to walk you through it. And he's guaranteed your victory ultimately for sure. And possibly through this trial. And remember this for sure, God, people see God with us in the trial. Let me just tell you that again. People see God with us in the trial. People see God with us in the trial. You know what? This whole prosperity thing is like, yeah, God's with me and my six, you know, Cadillacs. And I guess I got to stop using Cadillacs. That was over 20 years ago, but whatever. My six Hyundais. Yes, God's with me with my, you know, who's the guy with the diamond on his cane? He's with the diamond on my cane. Really? Your last name's Dollar? I don't think so. All right. Okay. That's another story. Listen. People are like, I don't see God there. But you know where people can see God in your life? When you're in the trial. You want to be used by God? When you find yourself, I'm not saying go look for it, but when you find yourself in the trial, you make sure they see God. That's what happens here. Verse 26, as we rush to the close of Daniel 3, then Nebuchadnezzar came as close as he could to the door of the flaming furnace and shouted, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out, come here. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego stepped out of the fire. Isn't it funny that these boys, as soon as they got to the bottom of the fire and their bonds were loosed, their ties were loose, why didn't they just jump out of the fire? Why didn't they be like, woo, we got to get out of here? You know why? Because Jesus was there. And they're like, yeah, Lord, we're good with you here. And so they're just like cruising around in the fire. Why didn't they jump out? Because they met Jesus in the middle of their fiery trial, and it was more important than getting out of the trial. They met Jesus in the midst of their trial, and their meeting him and knowing him there was more important than them getting out of the trial. That's what I see. There's something more valuable than just avoiding all the trials in our life. What's more valuable is meeting Christ in the midst of those trials. But the king's like, come on, guys. Come on out of there. Explain to me what's going on. So they're like, okay, we got to jump out for a minute, Jesus. You know, thanks. Thanks for being here. See you soon. We got to step out and talk to the king. Daniel 3, verse 27. Listen, I'm being light, okay, because it just is it, so you can hear me, all right, so you don't check out. I want you to understand how real this is. I've seen this in people's lives, and it blows my mind. And when I see it, I say, Lord, number one, please. You know, I say, you know, I don't do what I do. Do what God's word says. I say, Lord, please don't ever give me the opportunity, you know, to have that level of faith. You know, Because, you know, you got to go through a fiery trial to display that level of faith. But when I see somebody in it, and I see this kind of faith, it strengthens me greatly. And it strengthens everyone around them. Look what it does to King Nebuchadnezzar. Verse 27, then the high officers, officials, governors, and advisors crowded around them and saw that the fire had not touched them. Not a hair on their heads was singed and their clothing was not scorched. They didn't even smell like smoke. Listen, remember, if you're in a fiery trial, God's purpose is to use you to bring him glory, to grow the kingdom and to impact the people around you. Don't let him down. Daniel 3, verse 28, then Nebuchadnezzar said, praise the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. That's what we call success in a trial. Praise the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He sent his angel to rescue his servants who trusted him. They defied the king's command, look at this last line, and were willing to die rather than serve or worship any god except their own God. They were willing to die rather than to bow to any other little g god, which means your ease, your comfort, yourself, or this world. They were willing to die rather than serve or worship any god of this world, and it has an impact on the king. Here's the impact, verse 29 of Daniel 3. Therefore, the king says, I make this decree. If any people, whatever their race or nation or language, speak a word against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they will be torn limb from limb, and their houses will be turned into heaps of literally dung. Dung heaps. Heaps of rubble. All right. Here's the next line. Look at it closely. There is no other God who can rescue like this. That's the purpose in a fiery trial, is to get someone around us to say, you know what? Your God thing is real. Your relationship with Jesus Christ is real. I see him in you while you're in this fire. Verse 30, then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to even higher positions in the province of Babylon. Listen, unfortunately, this is the last time we see these guys. They just go off and have massive impact. What do you think their impact is for God in the province of Babylon? What do you think their impact is to encourage the Jews who are in captivity? Hey, aren't you the guys that got thrown into the smelting furnace and the king saw Jesus in there? Well, they wouldn't say Jesus. They may say Mashiach. They may say, you know, the king saw Messiah in there, the deliverer in there with you. Yeah, that's us. What are you doing now? Well, let me tell you, they had a testimony, did they not? And so they were promoted to even higher positions, and God used them. Here's what you need to know, okay? Here's what you need to know. What if we truly believed like these three servants of God believed? What if we believed that God would do what was best for us and for his glory? What if we truly believed that God was in charge, that God was sovereign, that God was at work? What if, listen carefully to me, don't be distracted. What if we stopped fighting? What if we stop demanding to have our own way? Did you hear me? What if we stop defending what we wanted for our own position? What if we were to say with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, Lord, I don't need to defend myself. I don't need to tell you what to do. You, God, whom I serve with everything I have, you are able to save, and you will rescue me. And I will stand. And I will stand in the midst of this, and I will trust you no matter what. And one thing, God, I will commit to you today, I will never bow. I will never bow to my self-serving needs. I will never bow to this world. I won't bow to the pressure. I will stand in complete faith and complete confidence in you no matter what comes, because, Lord, I know the worst is that you would rescue me from this world. That's the worst that could happen, and I'm going to stand on that in every fiery trial with my faith complete, that you are both able to save and you will rescue. May God be glorified. May God be glorified in the midst of our fiery trials. May we meet him in the midst of our fiery trials like we can meet him no other way. May we experience his touch, in the midst of our trials. May we long to know Him. May we seek Him. May we cling to Him. May we turn from the ways of the world and the flesh. And may we hold on to Jesus Christ firmly in the midst of our trials. Let's pray. Let's pray. Just bow your heads and listen. I'm going to read a section out of Isaiah 43, the first three verses, and make this your prayer, okay? Make this your prayer right now. Lord, you say in Isaiah 43, Lord, you say, do not be afraid, for I have ransomed you. And Lord, I confess I'm afraid, Lord, but I hold on to that word and say, Lord, help me. Remove my fear, Lord. Help me to know that you've ransomed me. Lord, you say I've called you by name. You're mine. And I say, Lord, I am yours. You have called me by name, Lord. And you say, Lord, when I go through deep waters, that you'll be with me. And Lord, I'm in deep waters and I know that you're with me, Lord. And you say, when I go through the rivers of difficulty, I won't drown. And Lord, I trust that. I look for you, Lord. My hand is on you. My eyes are set on you. And you, Lord, say that when I walk through the fire of oppression, that I will not be burned up, that the flames will not consume me. And I stand on that today, Lord. I stand on that today, God. Lord, I'm in a fire, Lord, and I believe that I will not be burned up. I believe that the flames will not consume me, Lord. God, you say that you are Lord, that you are God, that you are the Holy One of Israel, that you're my Savior, Lord. And I stand on that rock and I will stand no matter what I see, no matter what I feel, no matter what circumstances come, no matter how hot the trial is, I will stand in my faith in you, God. Let's stand up, everybody. Lord, I know that you're my healer. I know that you're my rescuer, Lord. I know, God, that you will bring me through this, Lord. Sing it out to him right now. Make this your prayer. Make this your prayer, Lord Jesus. You're all I need, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Make this your prayer. Thank you, Lord.